So the part of the chapter that I want to focus on is specifically in verse number 13, where the Bible says, distributing to the necessity of saints, given to hospitality. Given to hospitality. And that's the title of my sermon, is given to hospitality. And that's why I'm going to preach about the importance of hospitality, of being hospitable, and of having charity. And we'll see here in a minute that those two words are used interchangeably. Now, this is something that's lacking majorly in just Bible-believing churches today. And it's not being taught very much is the reason why. And specifically, hospitality is what I'm going to talk about for the majority of the sermon. And I'll tie in charity to that in the, towards the end of the sermon. But this is something that's lacking majorly in churches today, and even more so in independent Baptist churches. When you go to independent Baptist churches, this is very obvious. And while modern Christianity and contemporary Christianity is apostatizing right now, they're going too far to one side of the spectrum, where they just want to preach only the positive messages, only the messages about God is love, only the messages about happiness and things like that, and they want to ignore all of the negative messages. And sometimes us, because we're fundamentalists, because we believe every word of the Bible, we actually read our Bible in our personal time. We can sometimes overreact to that and go too far to the other side of the spectrum. And we can start, preaching too much of just the negative stuff, or even just focusing too much on the negative things in the Bible. So we need to make sure that we keep a good balance of the positive and the negatives in our life to have a good Christian life. And there's a lot of positive in the Bible as well. And you wonder, what is the exact balance that we should have? What's whatever balance that the Bible gives us? Whether that's, 50-50, which there's more negative things in the Bible than there is positive. But that would be the perfect balance that we should have. We should have the balance that the Bible has. And this is an extremely important doctrine. It's not just a minor doctrine in the New Testament. The Bible teaches that hospitality and charity is the most important Christian value that you can have in your Christian life. 100%. And I'm going to show that here later on in the sermon. So the reason why this would be applicable to this is obviously because it's a new church. I was gonna be preaching, last Sunday, but I wasn't in town, and I had a sermon that I was thinking in my mind. I hadn't written it, and it was gonna be about the importance of going to church. And then Brother Miller preached on the necessity of church, so I had to scratch that idea. And then throughout the day on Sunday, I started thinking, well, what am I going to preach now? I got to change it. So I said, I'm going to preach, hopefully we have new faces that come in, people that have been looking for a church. Now I'm going to preach about using this church as an opportunity to start serving God more. And then Brother Rick Martinez preached exactly just that. So I had to preach something different. I wanted it to be applicable to it being a new church. And I think this is as applicable as you could be as far as being hospitable and being charitable to people, because we're trying to grow this church. We want to get people in the doors, not to line somebody's pocket, but rather that we could, get people working and send them out into the harvest and start knocking doors and winning souls to Christ. So we want to get new people in here, and you have to have unity in the local church. And the way that you have unity, like it talks about in Philippians 2, to have unity is you have to be like-minded. But the thing about that also is, on top of that, is that you can't just be like-minded in the sense that everybody's selfish, because then you're not going to have unity. You have to be like-minded in the sense that you have the mind of Christ. And that's what it talks about specifically in Philippians chapter 2. So we need to have the things that Christ had. And one of those is hospitality. One of those is charity, loving other people. So look down, like I said, at Romans chapter 12, verse 13, where the Bible reads, distributing to the necessity of saints, given to hospitality. Notice the context. So we'll start in verse 3. For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Verse 4. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we, being many, are one body in Christ, and everyone members one of another. So the context of this chapter is he's talking about spiritual gifts, but he's talking about the local church. He's talking about the different attributes and different values and different gifts that the local church should have. These are things that he admonishes us to have, because you need these things in order to have unity in the local church. We actually find the definition to the word hospitality in verse 13. The Bible says, distributing to the necessity of saints, and then he follows it up, the semicolon. Semicolons, for a quick grammatical lesson, when a semicolon is used, normally it's going to rephrase the same thing. Even in modern English, there's nothing different about this. It's normally going to rephrase the same thing, or it's going to keep talking about the same subject, just give you a different detail about that subject. And that's what he does here. He says, give in to hospitality. So the definition of hospitality is distributing to the necessity of saints. It would be giving something, someone something that they need. It would be helping someone in an area that they're in need. And our modern word hospital comes from the same root word of hospitality. And why do you go to the hospital? You go to the hospital because you're in need. You need them to help you with something. You know, and you go there to get medical treatment and they help you. Now, turn in your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 2. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 2. Now, there's four mentions of the word hospitality in the Bible. So we're going to look at all four of them. But like I said, there's other synonymous words that are used in the Bible. And this is a major subject in the New Testament. It's in all of Paul's letters. It's obviously, we can see it in the life of Christ, and he teaches on it in a lot of different ways. So it's a major subject in the Bible. So turn to 1 Timothy chapter 3. And one thing I want to say first, before I read this, a lot of people have this feeling while they're doing their Bible reading, when they read like 1 Timothy chapter 3 or Titus chapter 1, because of their qualifications of bishops, you know, they feel like, well, this doesn't necessarily apply to me. Maybe they're a woman, or maybe they just don't have the desire to ever be a pastor. Or maybe they've already been disqualified from something on this list, and they just feel like, well, these things just don't qualify for me. Don't apply to me because I just can't be a pastor. I don't have the desire to be a pastor. But the Bible says that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. It's not some passages aren't, you know, just profitable to some people, and other passages are profitable to other people. When we read through here, every single qualification are commandments to Christians that are giving elsewhere also. So these qualifications are things that you as a Christian should be doing in your life anyways. You know, nobody just wants to be, or nobody should just want to be, or be satisfied with being a mediocre Christian. All the things on these lists, I don't care if you desire to be a pastor or not, you should be trying to meet the things on these on this list no matter what in your life.
Amen.
You know, obviously the ladies shouldn't be trying to be the husband of one wife, but if you're a man, you know, and you look at this list, and it says a husband of one wife, that's not only written to a bishop. That's something that you should do too. You know, you shouldn't go out and commit adultery either. This is just high standards that God holds for every Christian. But if you're going to take the office of a bishop, if you're going to be running his church, he makes sure 100% that you have met these qualifications. Now, I'm going to point out something on that idea here. So look at verse 1 where it says, this is a true saying. If a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach. So notice the exact same wording or the exact same phrase is used here that was used in Romans chapter 12, verse 13. In Romans chapter 12, verse 13, he was just speaking to the church in general. Here he's speaking specifically to Christians, which just further proves my point of what I just now said a minute ago, that it's not just written to it's not just written to pastors. It's the exact same commandment that's given in other places. And what does it mean? What would it mean to be given to hospitality? It means that it's something that you're doing regularly. It's something that you're doing often. You know, if I was just hospitable one time in my life, I'm not given to hospitality. It means it's a part of your routine. It's a part of your personality. And hospitality isn't something that, hey, that's just for that guy. That's a spiritual gift that he has. It's not something that I have. You know, it's not something for me, or I don't have the aptitude to be hospitable, or I don't have the aptitude to be charitable. This is something that is for every single Christian. And I bring that up now because this isn't something that's just for pastors in this context, this passage. It's written to every Christian. That's why the commandment was given in Romans chapter 12 too. So if you're not a hospitable person, then you need to work on it. It's not just something to dismiss and then go on, well, that's one of my weaknesses. We need to learn. We need to work on our weaknesses. So given to hospitality means that it's something that's a part of your everyday life. It should be a part of your personality. You should be a hospitable person. A person that's given to hospitality is a person that you can look at and say, hey, he's a hospitable person. Somebody that's not given to hospitality isn't someone that you could say he's a hospitable person. You couldn't apply that to that person. Now, turn to 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. We're going to go to the third mention of the word hospitality. So we've already seen two mentions of the four of hospitality. Whoops. 1 Peter chapter 4, we'll begin reading in verse number 7. The Bible says, but the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. And above all things have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Shall cover the multitude of sins. Verse 9, use hospitality one to another without grudging. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So my first point was we need to be given to hospitality. It needs to be a part of our everyday life. It needs to be a part of our routine. My second point is that we need, hospitality is something that we must use. It's something that we must do. Hospitality is an act. It's something that you have to go out of your way to do. It's not just a thought or it's not just a feeling. See, love is just an emotion. I can love my wife, but that doesn't mean that I show her that I love her. I can love my wife on the inside and not treat her well. Hospitality is actually showing love, is actually showing someone that you care. Now, hospitality, here in this chapter where it says, use hospitality one to another without grudging, proves one thing though. It proves that you could be hospitable. You could be just going through the motions and not actually meaning it and not actually being sincere. So the definition of hospitality is just referring to the act. It's simply only referring to the nature of what you're doing. It doesn't even necessarily mean that you actually mean what you're doing, or that you actually care, that you're genuine, or that you're sincere about what you're doing. Now, another thing in this verse is that we find in verse number 10, notice the words that it uses. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister. Ministering is something that you do as far as work. Keep reading. Minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So notice two words there that refer to someone that's doing work. Again, showing that hospitality is the work. It's something that you have to go out of your way to do. It's not just a feeling. Now look at verse number 8. We're going to see a synonym of the word hospitality right here. It says, and above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves. For charity shall cover the multitude of sins. If we were just talking, you know, and I wasn't preaching the sermon, I came up to you and I said, hey, I have a bunch of possessions and I have some things in my house, some clothes, all kinds of stuff, that I'm going to take and I'm going to go down to, you know, like the Salvation Army, and I'm going to give it away to the Salvation Army. You would say that that's very charitable. That's probably the word that we would use today. You know, I would be giving it to a charity, which is the exact definition of what we saw of hospitality, right? It said distributing to the necessity of saints. It was giving something to people that they need. Now, God couples words together all the time to give you a greater understanding of another word. Now, these words are synonyms, but all words you can find a synonym with, but you'll also find a little bit of a difference in those two words, just a slight difference. And I'll tell you the difference between charity and hospitality is charity is sincere. The word charity in the Greek actually comes from the same word that our word love comes from. It's translated from the exact same word, but it has that slightly different meaning. Now, you get a definition of the word charity in this passage. So let's read again verse 8. It says, and above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Now look at verse 9. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. Now hospitality is just the work, but charity is specifically doing the work without grudging. It's specifically doing the work and actually enjoying it or taking pleasure in it. Actually like or enjoying that you're helping someone. Now turn, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. There's a wide variety of different things that you could do as far as like applications for this, of how to help other people. But everybody has different needs, right? So there's different things that you can do for one person over here that, you know, maybe they just need, you know, just a welcome and a handshake. Or maybe this person's down their luck and they need some money. Maybe this person over here, you know, maybe needs you to save their life. I mean, it could be a very extreme example of what's going on. Maybe you're an expert, you're proficient in a specific trade, like you know how to work on cars, you know how to do drywall or electricity, things like that. And somebody's building a house or they need help in an area like that. You don't have to wait for them to come to you. You can go to them for the opportunity to try to distribute to the necessity of the saints, to try to help other people and go to them and offer your help to them. Now, in 1 Corinthians 13, where you're at here, I'm going to read to you. I don't have this written down, but I'm going to read to you from another location. Titus chapter 1, which is the other area where the qualifications of the bishop is given. In Titus chapter 1, we also find another good definition of the word charity. So it says in Titus chapter 1, and I'll start reading verse number 7, it says, for a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God. not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre. And then verse 8 says this, but a lover of hospitality. That would be charity, a person that enjoys helping other people, a person that loves hospitality, that is sincere or genuine in when they're helping someone. So number one point is that we need to be given to hospitality. It needs to be something that we do in our everyday lives. It needs to be something that is often or regular. It shouldn't just be something, well, I did my hospitality last Sunday. You know, this Sunday when I come to church, I'm not really in the mood to, you know, be hospitable to people. It should be something that we're doing all the time. Every day in our lives. It should be a part of our personality. Once it becomes a part of your personality, you know, then that means you're doing it all the time. You just can't help but do it. Number two is it's something that you use. That means it's something that you do or work. You have to go out of your way. It's not just a thought that you have. You can care about other people. You can love other people. You know, you can even be sincere, but you actually have to do the work. And then the number third point puts the first two together, and that's that we need to have sincere hospitality. We need to actually do the work. But we also need to be sincere about it, and we need to be genuine about it. We need to have charity specifically, which would be the definition of what that is. Now, the context of chapter 13 here in 1 Corinthians, here in 1 Corinthians 12, the chapter that just precedes this, is a parallel of where we started out in Romans chapter 12. And they actually are both about spiritual gifts of the church. They're both written to the church, and they're about spiritual gifts that are given to all the church members. And he goes through a big long list of giving these different gifts, and all the different members have all these different gifts. And then he starts out in 1 Corinthians chapter number 13, we'll start reading right there. It says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. So he goes through the list. In 1 Corinthians 12, of all the gifts, then in the beginning, in the introduction of the next chapter, the very beginning of the next chapter, he's trying to illustrate a point. So he lists all of those gifts that are in 1 Corinthians 12. And he says, though I have the gift of prophecy, though I understand all mysteries, and though I have all knowledge, and, you know, and though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and then he says at the very end of verse 2, and that I have all faith that I could even remove mountains, and he says, and I have not charity, he says, I am nothing. And if you today have many gifts, if you're a great preacher, you know, if you're able to stand up behind the pulpit and preach a great sermon, if you're able to write a good sermon, if you're able to speak many languages and go out door to door and communicate with many different people, even if you have an extreme amount of faith, but you don't have charity, you have nothing. Your Christian life is worth nothing if you do not have charity in your Christian life. And this is one of the reasons why, because people say, you know, what do I need to do to be a great soul winner? You know, what do I need to do? You need to have charity, number one, because when you go to people's doors, you have to actually care about the people that you're knocking on their doors. Yep. This is the same. When people come to my door and they knock on my door, people talk to me about things, I can see whether that person is genuine or not, or whether they're sincere or not. And if you go to someone's door and you're just going through the motions and you don't have compassion, you don't care about the person that you're knocking on their door, they can see that. And they're not going to be likely to listen to you. I don't want to listen to someone that's trying to sell me a product that they're not interested in. Or I don't want to listen to someone that's trying to explain something and convince me or persuade me about some sort of idea that they don't even believe themselves. Or they, you know, their heart's not even really truly in it. It's not interesting to me. So if you want to be a good soul winner, you know one of the number one things you need to work on? You need to have charity. You need to be hospitable. You need to care about other people.
Amen.
Right? Number two thing, that say your marriage. Say you're, you know, you want to have a great marriage. Well, you need to have charity. Remember in 1 Peter, it said charity covers a multitude of sins. With all relationships. So obviously, you know, husbands and wives are going to do each other wrong more than other people in their lives, more than friends will, because they're around each other more, because they share more things, more possessions and stuff like that. But also in other relationships, you need to make sure that you have charity or you won't be able to have a good relationship with anyone. You need to make sure. And what was charity? It was forgiving, was one of the things. It said it covers a multitude of sins. You need to have charity in every area of your life. To be a good church member, you have to have charity. You have to be hospitable. When somebody walks through the door and they feel like, you know, it looks like, oh, they're uncomfortable, you should look at that person and care, like, hey, I'm going to go over and talk to this person. I'm going to make sure that I try to make them feel welcome. I try to make them feel, you know, comfortable here at our church. Now, we're going to go through here in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're going to keep reading down through here, but notice in verse 3, right the very first verse where it says, "And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor," that's hospitality, isn't it? To give all your goods to feed the poor. "And though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing." Even if you do a good act and you go out of your way and you're hospitable and you do something great, excuse me, you give everything that you have away, but you didn't have charity and you didn't mean it, it meant nothing. You literally got zero rewards for it in heaven. You can give your whole house away and God will reward you nothing if you didn't sincerely mean it. It means nothing. He said, "I am nothing." Keep reading, verse 4. So it personifies charity here. It'll start doing that now. "Charity suffereth long." So it's patient is what it's talking about. "And is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself." So it's talking about being prideful. And then same thing right here. "Is not puffed up." Puffed up. "Doth not behave itself unseemly. Seeketh not her own." So it's not selfish. Charity isn't selfish. It's someone that's looking out for other people. "Seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil." And a lot of times the word evil in the Bible means harm. So it's talking about like thinking harm to other people. Thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, believeth all things. Now when that says believeth all things, it's talking about being trusting. It's not talking about yourself being trustworthy, but it's talking about being trusting of other people. It believes all things. When a person walks you, obviously we need to have discernment. But if we're dealing with something with the saints and a person comes up to you and tells you about something or says, "Hey, I promise I'll do it for you," you know, and it's a saint that you're speaking to, it's a brother or sister in Christ, you should assume that that person is telling you the truth. Amen. You should give them the benefit of the doubt. You should believe all things. If you have charity, the Bible teaches that you'll be trusting, that you'll believe all things. You know, I'm not saying that there isn't times when we should be suspicious of certain things and that we shouldn't have discernment. You know, we should have wisdom, we should have discernment. If there's a reason why we should be skeptical about something, then that's understandable. That we need to take that into account too. But we also need, as our default, we just need to be trusting of other people. That should be how we operate our life. Now keep reading. In verse number 7, it says, "Hopeth all things, endureth all things." Verse 8, "Charity never faileth. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away." So he says, charity never fails. If you were to be a charitable person today, you could be a charitable person for the rest of your life until you die. If you speak a foreign language, you're probably not going to speak that language on your deathbed. If you speak multiple foreign languages and it's not your mother tongue, you're probably, you know, not going to be able to speak that on your deathbed. If you speak multiple of them, not all of them for sure. There will be, you know, I'm sure if you went to certain people that have studied languages their whole life and they spoke 12, 13 languages, and you went to that person at the end of their life and they lived a very long life, to where they became, you know, decrepit and old and everything, and you spoke to that person, I bet that they couldn't fluently speak those languages. Those languages would fail. You know, knowledge that you learn in the Bible, you're going to forget some of that stuff. Prophecies, the ability to preach, to be able to stand up behind a pulpit, to be able to, you know, put a message together, you know, to be able to preach a sermon, that will fail. You will lose the ability. If you could preach today, you will someday lose the ability to be able to preach. But if you're a charitable person, it's something that you can have for the rest of your life. It's an attribute or a personality trait that you can have for the rest of your life. Keep reading verse number 9. "For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things." Now I'm going to refer back to this verse here in just a minute. So keep this, remember this verse right here. Charity is a sign of maturity. Not only maturity, you know, in your everyday life as far as physically, but it's a sign of maturity spiritually as well. Now keep reading, verse 12. "For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known." Now watch verse 13. "And now abideth faith, hope, charity. These three, but the greatest of these is charity." And you don't hear this preached very much. You don't hear messages on charity and hospitality in your average independent Baptist church. But the Bible is very clear over and over and over again that charity is the greatest Christian value that you could have in your life. Let that sink in. It is the greatest Christian value that you can have in your life. And if you had all other skills and you had all other knowledge in your life, and you don't have charity, the Bible says you're nothing still. That you're nothing. You're meat, you can't do anything for God. It doesn't mean anything for God. Look at Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, and we'll see this again, where the Bible lifts up charity and exalts charity as being the greatest value that you could have, or the greatest attribute that you could have. So Colossians chapter 3, look at verse number 12. Put on therefore as the elect of God, holy and beloved, vows of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another, even if any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. Now watch verse 14. And above all these things, put on charity. Above all these things. Go through the list again. Verse number 12. He says, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another. And one thing you'll notice too, these are all attributes that charity has. These were all attributes, long-suffering, you know, being forgiving, trusting of other people. When it personified charity, it used these attributes to describe charity. Personality traits that it said that charity already had. That's because charity is at the very top of the chain. It's the highest level of maturity of Christianity. And I'll further prove that by verse 14. It says, and above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. That's the end. When you get to charity, that's where you finish. That's where you've become, you know, the ultimate Christian. That's where you've become. Because the Bible talks about spiritual growth. Talks about spiritual maturity. When you're saved, all you have is faith. You start out with faith. That's when you're saved and you're a babe in Christ. And you acquire things down the road. You acquire things. You may have a little bit of charity, right? You may have a little bit of charity in the beginning. You could be, you know, try to be a hospitable person. Maybe it's not sincere. Maybe you're working your way that, you know, in that direction. But to have full, sincere charity, that's at the very end of the growth of a Christian life. Now, one other thing that you might not have noticed when we read 1 Peter before, in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8, it says the same thing. It says, and above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. So here it says, and above all these things, talking about the list that he gave. And then in 1 Peter, what we read before, it says, and above all things. So he doesn't even give you a list. He just says, it's the greatest thing that you could have. It's the greatest attribute or personal trait that you could have in your Christian life is charity. It's, you know, it's hospitality, sincere hospitality. Now, let's go over to, turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. Second Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. I'm going to read to you some other verses about charity. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12. The Bible says, let no man despise thy youth. So this is Paul writing to Timothy. But be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity. We should be an example in charity. In spirit, in faith, in purity. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10. But thou hast fully known my doctrine. Now, Paul's writing to Timothy, but he's talking about himself. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22, he's writing to Timothy again. He says, flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Now, like I was talking about a minute ago, I said charity is basically the top level of Christian maturity. And I'm going to read 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 5. Keep that in mind. And remember earlier I said, hey, remember that verse in 1 Corinthians 13 when it said, you know, when I was a child, I spake as a child, I thought as a child, I understood as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. So a sign of maturity is charity. That's what he's saying. In context of talking about charity, he said, I put away childish things, talking about now I'm charitable. No, to be a mature Christian, you have to have charity. Look at 2 Timothy, or I'll read you from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. It says, and beside all this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue. So that's the first step. When you get saved, all you have is faith. Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness. And then he says this, and to brotherly kindness charity. And that's the end. That is the perfectness, as it put over in Colossians, of the Christian life. That's the ultimate step of maturity as a Christian. It's the greatest. The Bible exalts it in an extreme way. It says, and now abideth, you know, and now abideth faith, hope, charity. These three. But the greatest of these is charity. The greatest thing you could have as a value in your Christian life is to be charitable. Now you're in, what did I say, 2 Thessalonians? 2 Thessalonians. Was it chapter 1, verse 3? Yeah. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. Now, like to review the points real quick. Number one, we need to be given to hospitality. It needs to be something that's a part of our everyday life. Number two, we need to use hospitality, as in something we need, it's work that we need to do. It's not just a thought that we have. It's not just love in itself. We actually need to get to work. We need to go out of our way to help people, to greet people, to do all kinds of different things like that. Point number three is that it needs to be sincere hospitality. It needs to be, specifically, it needs to be charity. We need to have charity for other people. And remember, in 1 Peter, I didn't point this out, but it said, have fervent charity. So we should have a strong charity. A fervent like comes from the word like fire. We need to have love in our hearts for other people when we do it. And that brings me to my next point. My last point is who and when should we do these things? And the Bible teaches very clearly, and a lot of people might think, well, that doesn't sound right to me. But that we should primarily show charity and hospitality to those that are of the household of faith, those that are other believers, those that are saints. That should be our major focus in our life. I'm not saying don't be hospitable and don't be charitable to other people. But you should actually make sure in your Christian life, number one, that you are being charitable and hospitable to those that are saved, to those that are saints. If you would have noticed, all of those verses about being hospitable, all the admonishments and the exhortations to be hospitable were all written to be hospitable to saints, to be right. Charitable to saints. Every one of them. Romans chapter 12, verse 13, I'll read a couple of them, said, distributing to the necessity of saints. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8 said, and above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves. And then the context of Colossians chapter 3, verse 12 said, put on therefore as the elect of God. So he's writing to those that are saved, the Christians. Holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. And then he says, forbearing one another. He's talking about helping one another, helping each other. So look down at 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3, and we'll see that further. It says, we are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith groweth exceedingly, and the charity of every one of you all toward each other aboundeth. So notice what he commends them on is the charity that they give to one another. Not just in general, but specifically the charity that they have with one another. Now, turn to another passage, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 14. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 14. First Peter chapter 5, verse 14. The Bible says at the end, greet ye one another with a kiss of charity. Peace be with you all that are in Christ Jesus. Amen. So now he's talking about greetings, about welcoming other people. And obviously there's a major difference in our culture than there was at that time. If I went up and another guy walked in, I'd kiss him on the cheek. You know, I don't think he'd take that very nicely, and I wouldn't enjoy it, to be honest. You know, we live in a culture that's much different. And when we welcome or we greet other people, you know, we give handshakes. You know, other people in other cultures, they wouldn't, you know, give a handshake as often as we would. You know, they would give a kiss on the cheek. Men would give another man a kiss on the cheek. But in our culture, that's not how we greet other people. It's just a difference in culture. So, but it's just showing that we need to greet those other people that are in the faith with charity. We need to greet other saints when they come in the door, you know, with charity. There shouldn't be a single person that walks in this door, you know, especially a saved believer that's looking for a church. They're just visiting, that we don't go up to and greet. There's no reason why a person should walk in, sit down, listen to the preaching, sing the hymns, get up, and walk out without a single person talking to them. Mm-hmm. That should never, ever happen. You should go out of your way to greet, you know, every person you can, but especially people that are walking in. Because what is it? Hospitality is given to the necessity of saints. And something that people need is a handshake. Something, you know, people feel... very uncomfortable when they visit a new church sometimes. Extremely uncomfortable the first time they walk in. Some people are different than others. When I visit a new church, to be 100% honest, I'm not very shy, so I don't feel that uncomfortable. You know, like when we went on a trip recently, and on the way, we stopped Wednesday night so we wouldn't miss service at another church. We were going up to the Red Hot Preaching Conference. And my wife and my daughter were like super nervous. I couldn't understand why. I'm just not a shy person. I just don't have any kind of problem of walking up to people and saying, hey, how you doing? And if you know me, you know that's not my personality. But a lot of people are that way. And it's not just something that's between difference between men and women. A lot of men are shy. It's just a certain personality trait that some people have. And you know what? It goes a long way when somebody walks in the door and they are a shy person and you walk up to them and you say, hey, man, you know, what's your name? It's great to, you know, how'd you hear about the church? It's great to meet you. You know, and give them your name. Sit there and talk to them for a few minutes. Sit there and chat with them for a few minutes. It means a lot to people. Now, I told you to turn to, we already read 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 14. Turn to Philippians chapter 4, verse 21. Philippians chapter 4, verse 21. I'll read to you quickly also from Titus chapter 3, verse 15. It says, all that are with me salute thee. So he says, everyone that's with me is saluting you. It's greeting. And then he says this. Watch what he says. Greet them that love us in the faith. Grace be with you all. Amen. Over and over again, you see these admonitions or these exhortations to greet other people, to salute other people, right? And notice who he said to greet. Greet them that love us in the faith. You know, greet the saints, greet the brethren. But Philippians chapter 4, verse 21, I'll read from there. Philippians chapter 4, verse 21 is where you are. The Bible says, salute every saint in Christ Jesus. The brethren which are with me greet you. You should try every single person when you're walking around in church to say hi to every person. Every single person that you can. Obviously, the larger the church gets, the harder that it, you know, that it becomes to greet every single person. But right now, it's not very hard. There's not very many people here. So there's not a reason why, you know, I said before there's not a reason why one person should walk in and leave. There's not a reason why anybody should come in this door with the amount of people that's here. And you shouldn't say hello and give your name and shake their hand and say hi, you know, good to hear, and have good conversation with someone and actually be sincere and actually be genuine and actually mean it. There's no reason why. That's how you have unity. If you had a bunch of people that walked in here and sat down and didn't pay any attention to each other, you're not going to have unity. You're not going to have unity. There's not going to be a bond there between all the other brothers like there should be. And I'll give you a personal testimony to me. Like I said, I'm not very shy. I'm not. And when I came and I visited Faithful Word Baptist Church, you know, it was over 2 years ago. It would be 2 years this past June. And when I came to visit, I had already pretty much made my mind up that I was moving. The purpose that I came, I actually stayed with Brother Charlie. The purpose that I came was that I was going to, you know, go around as many companies as I could in my field, in my trade, and put in applications, put in resumes. And then I was also going to go around and try to find a place for myself and my family and I to live. When I visited the church, I had heard the preaching for a long time, and I grew up an independent Baptist my whole life. I went to Christian schools my whole life. My very first Sunday that I could go to church, I was brought to an independent Baptist church. So, very similar to Faithful Word in a lot of ways. We were King James only. You know, I heard hard preaching while I was growing up. You know, we sang traditional hymns only, salvation by grace through faith alone. There was soul winning. It wasn't, you know, consistent. It wasn't a lot, but there was soul winning. A lot of things were similar. And I had visited a lot of other, you know, independent Baptist churches growing up my whole life. And I went to the service, and when I went back home, my dad asked me, because he listens to Pastor Anderson sometimes too, and he had listened to him then at that time. He knew the church that I was going to, and he loves the church. And he asked me, he said, hey, well, how was it? And I'm sure he expected me to bring up the first thing, like, the sermon was awesome. But the very first thing that I told him, the very first thing that I told my wife, was I was like, man, everybody was very hospitable. It puts an impression on you. And I remember Brother Elliot said the exact same thing to me. You know, he said, man, people here are just so charitable, and they're so genuine, and they're so nice, and they're so sincere. And they come up to you, and they shake your hand, and they're so, you know, and it puts an impression on you. And like I said, I'm not a shy person. Imagine what it does to somebody who is a shy person, who was scared to come to church, who, you know, who was thinking about whether or not going in the door. And Pastor Anderson has other stories about, he knows of people that came to the church later, who sat outside and waited, and then ended up leaving, and then came back maybe to the next service, and then walked in and sat down. Imagine how much it would do to a person like that who walked up to you. It made a major impression upon me, you know. But look here as it says in Philippians chapter 4, verse 21, I just want to point out what it says. It says, salute every saint in Christ Jesus. We should make the attempt to try to talk to every single person that comes to church. We should make the attempt to try to talk to every single person that comes to church. Now turn to 3 John, verse 13. 3 John. Verse 13. Don't ask me which chapter. There's only one. So it's 3 John, verse 13. And when you get time, just do a word search. on salute and on greet and see how much it meant to people like Paul. Paul literally, in the book of Romans, when he wrote to Rome, he literally uses an entire chapter, the whole chapter of chapter 16, which is like 20 or 30 verses, not like 10. It's long. It's at least like 17 or 18, the upwards of the teens. The entire chapter is devoted to him just greeting other people. Salute these people. And you know, he always does it by name. He always names those people. Now look at 3 John verse 13, what it says here. I have many things to write, but I will not with ink and pen write unto thee. But I trust I shall shortly see thee, and we shall speak face to face. Peace be to thee. And then he says, our friends salute thee. So who's he talking about? He says, friends. The saints, right? The brethren. Then he says this at the very end. Greet the friends by name. So ways that we can be hospitable, ways that we can be charitable to others. A great way within the church to the saints is when they walk in the door, shake their hand. And make sure you know people's names. I get on my daughter about this all the time. When I shake, you have to memorize people's names. You have to. When I shake somebody's hand, it's a new person that I met, I walk away and I say their name in my mind like 20 times. So I can't. And then I'll tell you what else I do. When I'll look back at that person a couple times, and maybe they think I'm a weirdo, but I'll look back at that person and think their name in my mind. So that I can, I'm attaching that name with that face. So the next time I see that person, that's another thing. It seems like these are small things and they don't mean much. But when I walk up to a person, they're like, hey, Tyler, and I only met him and I had a short conversation with that person, that puts an impression on people. You think, well, obviously the conversation meant something to these people. You know, obviously when they walk away, they wanted for some reason to memorize my name. You know, just like me and Ellie were talking about this the other day, just like you have to memorize, you know, the more kids you have, all of their birthdays. It actually takes time to sit down and memorize their birthdays. Just, you know, just like when you have uncles and aunts and things like that, you know, and they memorize your birthdays, they know your birthdays. They don't just know them because they, every year, one time around, oh, they're born on this day. They actually sit down and they have to try to memorize birthdays. Do you have nieces and nephews and things like that? I'm sure you realize that, hey, if you have quite a few of them, it's not easy to memorize all of their birthdays. You have to actually spend time doing it. So, and it means a lot. So when you introduce yourself to someone, give your name to them, ask what their name is, and then memorize it. Memorize what their name is, and the next time you see them, shake their hand. And it's not an option. He says, greet the friends by name.
Amen.
That's not an option. It's a commandment to know the names of the saints, to know the names of the other believers, and to say, hi, Brother Charlie. Hi, Brother Adams. Hi, Brother Matt. Whatever. You know, it's a commandment to greet people by name. Now, different ways. I'm finished. We're not going to turn to another. Actually, I can try to find it while I talk, but there's another passage I thought of just a minute ago. But here's points to make this applicable. Now, obviously, like I said, and I mentioned these in the very beginning, you know, we should, number one, you know, we could, something very small is we could just shake people's hands, like we were just now talking about. Greet people. That's very important. It's emphasized very much in the Bible, in the New Testament. Number two is, if somebody needs money, if somebody needs help, you could give them money. If you're out to eat with someone, you could just offer, you know, hey, I'll just pay for your dinner. Hey, I'll pay for your lunch. That these are different ways to be charitable, different ways to be hospitable. If you have a trade, or if you have a skill, or if you have something, just a possession that other people need that you don't need, or you see, hey, this person's doing, you know, some project or something, and I have this and I don't really use it, just give it away if you don't use it. That's ways to be hospitable. If it's just sitting around, just give it away. If you have a skill, if you know how to put a roof on, if you know how to do electricity, plumbing, things like that, and you know that so-and-so's needs help, you know how to work on a car, and somebody's car's broke down, approach that person and say, hey, can I help you, you know, work on that? I would like to, you know, I know how to work on cars. Can I give you a hand, you know, working on that? Now, and I'm not exactly sure what this verse is, but the Bible says, you know, that we should have, number one, we should be given to hospitality. So that means that it's something that is a part of our everyday life. It's a part of our routine. It should be a part of your personality. If it's not, you need to work on it. Number two, we need to use hospitality, as in it's work that we do. You know, you have to go out of your way. You have to walk up to the door. You have to go do work for somebody. You have to go get that, you know, material or that possession that you have that whoever needs and give it to them. You know, it's work. You have to actually do something. You use hospitality. And number three point is that it needs to be sincere hospitality. It needs to be genuine. So that means that it needs to be charity. It needs to be from the heart. You know, you should have love in your heart when you do these things. And it's easy. I'll end on this last point. It would be easy to have the right heart in the beginning too. And to start, you know, I really want to serve God. And this is, you know, the Bible says this is the greatest attribute value that you could have. I mean, that's big. And you have that in your mind. You're like, I'm going to start serving God. And this is one of the ways that I want to start working on it. And you begin, putting these things into practice, shaking people's hands, being hospitable, being charitable to other people. But over time, it can turn into where you're just going through the motions. So you need to make sure that you keep up on these things, that it's coming from the heart, and that it's actually charity. So we need to be given to hospitality. It needs to be sincere hospitality. It needs to be charity. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for your word, and I thank you for all the teachings in your word that just help us to have great relationships, to help us to have great friends, that just help us to lead a happy life, dear Lord God, and one of the attributes of charity is that we would be selfless and not selfish, and we know that selfishness just makes people unhappy, dear Lord God. Help us to be a charitable person with our life, and help us to be humble, which is another attribute of being charitable. And we just ask you that you would be with us, dear Lord, for the rest of the day, and bless the preaching that we'll hear at Faithful Word in Tempe. And we thank you for this church that we have here, dear Lord God, and for the opportunity to come here and to serve you and to read your word. And in Jesus Christ's name, amen.